Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Fairfax Scene. I'm your host, Rachel Roth. In this edition, we'll be focusing on John Singleton Mosby, his raids, and his Rangers. On March 8, 1863, he made one of his most daring raids on Fairfax Courthouse. Here is the sesquicentennial commemoration of that event.
My name is Colonel John Singleton Mosby, and I'm an old man now, but I'm here to tell you a story about when I visited Fairfax Courthouse on March 9, 1863, during the War of the Late Unpleasantness. I had been meditating a raid on Fairfax Courthouse, where I knew there were many rich prizes, when fortunately Ames, a deserter from the 5th New York Cavalry, came to my command and supplied all the missing links in the chain of evidence. On the afternoon of March 8th, 29 men met me at Aldie. I did not communicate my purpose of making a raid on the headquarters of the commanding general at Fairfax Courthouse to any of the men except Ames, and not to him until we started. Just as I was about to mount my horse as I was leaving, I said to him,
"I shall mount the stars tonight. A sink lower than plummet ever sounded."
The men thought we were simply going down to make an attack on a picket post. It was late in the afternoon when we left Aldie. There was a melting snow on the ground with a drizzling rain. All this favored my plan. The darkness concealed us, and the horses treading on the soft snow made very little noise. We started down the Little River Turnpike, which runs by Fairfax Courthouse, to Alexandria. At Chantilly on the Little River Pike, there was also a strong cavalry outpost. I found out where there was a gap in the picket line between the two turnpikes and determined to penetrate it. I knew that if we succeeded in passing the outer line without alarming the pickets, we might reach the general's headquarters at the courthouse in comparative safety. The headquarters was so thoroughly girdled with troops that no one dreamed of the possibility of an enemy approaching them. The commander of the Union cavalry at that time was Colonel Piercy Windham. He had been greatly exasperated by my midnight forays on his outpost and mortified at his own unsuccessful attempts at reprisal. In consequence, he had sent me many insulting messages. I thought I would put a stop to his talk by gobbling him up in bed and sending him off to Richmond. He did not conceive that anyone had the audacity to pass his pickets and ride into his camps. When we got within 3 miles of Chantilly, we turned off to the right from the turnpike and passed unobserved through the picket line about midway between that place and Centerville, and reached the Warrenton Turnpike about halfway between Centerville and the courthouse. We were then 4 miles inside the enemy's line. Proceeding a short distance on the pike towards the courthouse, we turned off to the right, flanked the corps directly in front of us, and came into the town unmolested at 2 o'clock in the morning. With the exception of a few drowsy sentinels, all the troops in the town were asleep. Nothing of the kind had ever been attempted before during the war, and no preparations had been made to guard against it. Once inside the enemy lines, everything we discovered was as easy as falling off a log. As the night was pitch dark, it was impossible to tell from our appearance to which side we belonged. The names of all the cavalry regiments stationed there were familiar to us. So whenever a sentinel halted us, the answer was,
"5th New York Cavalry."
And it was all right. All of my men except Hunter and Ames were much surprised when they found themselves in a town filled with Union troops. As I had never led them into a place from which I was not able to take them out, there was not a faint heart among them. All seemed to have a blind confidence in my destiny. I had only 29 men, We were surrounded by hostile thousands. Ames, who also knew to what point he was piloting us, rode by my side. Without being able to give any satisfactory reason for it, I felt an instinctive trust in his fidelity, which he never betrayed. We had already cut the wires before we came into the town to prevent communication with Centerville. When we reached the courthouse square, which was appointed as a rendezvous, the men were detailed in squads. Some were sent to the stables to collect the fine horses that I knew were there, others to the different headquarters. We were more anxious to capture Wyndham than any other. There was a hospital on the main street in a building, which had been a hotel. A sentry was walking. The first thing I did was to send Ames and Franklin to relieve him from duty and to prevent any of the occupants from giving the alarm. A six-shooter has great persuasive powers. I went directly with the larger portion of the command to the house of a citizen named Murray, which I had been told was Wyndham's headquarters. This was not so. He told us that they were at Judge Thomas's house, which we had passed on the other end of the town. So we quickly returned to the courthouse square. Ames was sent with a party to Wyndham's headquarters. Two of his staff were found there asleep, but the bird we were trying to catch had flown. Wyndham had gone down to Washington that evening by the railroad. The irony of fortune made Ames the captor of his captain. He was Captain Barker, 5th New York Cavalry, detailed as Assistant Adjutant General. Joe had also caught a soldier who told him that he was one of the guards at General Stoughton's headquarters. This was the reason I did not go with Ames after Wyndham. I took 5 or 6 men with me to go after Stoughton. I remember the names of Joe Nelson, Hunter, White's Carver, Welt Hatcher, and Frank Williams. Stoughton was occupying a brick house on the outskirts of the village belonging to Dr. Gunnell. Joe Nelson saw a tent in the front yard. He went in and took the telegraph operator who was sleeping there.
Put your hands up, be quiet, and come with me.
What?
Get up, get up.
Don't shoot, I'm unarmed.
Get up.
Don't shoot.
Get up.
Don't move or I'll shoot you. Don't even look up.
You're
behind us. Who's there?
5th New York Cavalry with a dispatch for the general.
Footsteps were soon heard tripping downstairs. It was Lieutenant Prentice of the staff.
Now, Mosby, take me to the general.
We went straight upstairs where Stoughton was, leaving Welt Hatcher and George White's Carver behind to guard the horses. When a light was struck, we saw lying on the bed before us the man of war. He was buried in deep sleep. There were signs in the room of having been revelry in the house that night. Some uncorked champagne bottles furnished an explanation of the general's deep sleep. He had been entertaining a number of ladies from Washington in a style becoming a commanding general. He was turned over on his side, snoring like one of the 7 sleepers. I could not afford to await his convenience or to stand on ceremony. So I just pulled up his shirt and gave him a spank.
What's the meaning of this?
Do you know of Mosby?
Yes, have you caught him?
No, sir. I am Mosby and I have caught you. Dress quickly.
To deprive him of all hope of escape and to induce him to dress quickly, I deceived Stoughton.
Stuart's cavalry holds the town. General Jackson's in Centerville.
Fitz Lee, is he here?
Yes.
We were classmates at West Point. Will you take me to him? I'd very much like to see him.
Yes, sir, we will.
He had the reputation of being a gallant soldier, but a fop. He dressed before the looking glass as carefully as Sardanapalus did when he went into battle.
Quickly, I'm in a hurry. Come on, let's go.
In the hurry of departure, he forgot his watch and left it on the bureau. One of my men, Frank Williams, took it.
Hold on. Time up good, Hunter.
General, your watch, sir?
Thank you.
General?
White Scarver and Walt Hatcher, who had been left to guard the horses, had not been idle while we were in the house. They had surrounded some tents and captured 7 headquarters couriers, besides several fine horses, which we found bridled and saddled. I was determined to bring off the general, even if we had to abandon all our other captures. So I would not let Stoughton hold his bridle reins, but told Hunter to ride by his side and hold them at all hazards. I knew that Hunter would stick to him closer than a brother. Lieutenant Prentice also started with us a prisoner, but I let him hold his bridle reins. He left us in the dark and never even said good night.
On your feet, men. Go ahead and mount up White Scaver, I got him.
When we returned to the courthouse square, all the squads had collected there and duly done their work.
Let's move them out.
There were 29 men with me, and we had had about 100 prisoners and horses to guard. It was so dark that the prisoners did not know my men from their own. All was panic and confusion. We had spent an hour there raiding all the stables and headquarters and came away loaded down with prisoners and spoils without even firing a shot or having one fired at us. It is reported that Mr. Lincoln, when he heard of it, remarked with cynical humor that he didn't care so much about the general as he could make another in 5 minutes, but that he hated to lose those horses. March 9th, 1863, 150 years ago today. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much.
Mosby got his nickname, the Gray Ghost, for his ability to appear out of nowhere, strike with lightning speed, and then disappear into the night. Civil War historian Don Hakenson will tell us about some of Mosby's other raids.
John Singleton Mosby and the 43rd Battalion of Virginia Cavalry of Mosby's Rangers were probably, at the end of the war, the best armed, the best dressed, the best horsed cavalry unit in the Confederate Army, all courtesy of the U.S. government. The very first story I'm going to talk about occurred on the 6th of August of 1863. On the Little River Turnpike, Mosby's Rangers were looting a wagon.
And they're going through those wagons and they're taking everything that they possibly could. Coming from Alexandria was the 1st Maine Cavalry. And Mosby's Rangers, seeing the 1st Maine Cavalry, mount their horses, and what do you think they do? They start running as fast as they possibly can towards Fairfax Courthouse. But one lone ranger, he leads the group of rangers and he races to a tavern and he jumps off his horse and he runs into the building and he closes that door. There's 3 or 4 men from the 1st Maine. They're chasing that lone rider. They jump off their horse, they run over to the door and they grab that doorknob. It won't open. They can't get in. Now there's 2 stories about what happened. If you're reading a Southern report, they're going to refer to that tavern as Gooding's Tavern. If you're reading a Northern report, they're going to call it Coyle's Tavern. Mr. Gooding would die, and he would leave that tavern to his daughter, Jane Coyle. Jane Coyle would marry James Coyle. There's an Alexandria Gazette report and a Washington Star report. One of them has it, they're trying to open the door. They fire a shot through the door. And the other report is that James Coyle is opening the door. But nevertheless, James Coyle has taken a bullet in the abdomen. And he would fall back into another room, and he would fall on a bed, and he would raise his arms up in the air, and he would say, "I am a dead man." And those troopers from the 1st Maine would finally break through the door. They pull out their revolvers, they run in that room, and they start beating James Coyle from the upper part of the chest and the head. Jane Coyle, she walks up to the door and she sees these men pounding on her husband. And she says, "Leave that man alone. He has done nothing." And they keep pounding on his body. And finally, they lift up his body. They drag him through the doorway. They knock down Jane Coyle. They drag his body over top of hers, and they drag him outside, and they start beating on him again. James Coyle would die. There was an investigation conducted by a Lieutenant Colonel Daniel Delaney. And in his investigation, he would write about what happened at Gooding's Tavern, and he would state that they killed the wrong man. James Coyle was an Irishman, and he was a Union man. He said that James Coyle had saved his unit from ambush with Mosby's Rangers just a few months before. Nace Dade, a slave for the Goodings, is interviewed, and he says all the Goodings and all the Coyles are secesh, and that they killed the right man. I want to talk about a raid that occurred on the 27th or the 28th of September of 1863. John Singleton Mosby had about 5 or 6 men, and he wanted to come into Alexandria and capture the pretend governor of Virginia, the provisional government of Virginia. There's a statue of Governor Francis Pierpont, a very prominent individual. Mosby wants to capture this man. He makes his way into Alexandria. And he makes his way to the City Hotel. Does anybody know what the City Hotel is called in Alexandria today? Gadsby's Tavern. That was the City Hotel. That's where Francis Pierpont is staying. Pierpont is called into Washington City by Abraham Lincoln. And now Mosby has to change his mission. He has a ranger with him by the name of French Delaney. And he has found out that the aide to Francis Pierpont, Lieutenant Colonel Daniel Delaney, is staying at Manadier Mason's house, which is the Rose Hill Manor House, right outside of Alexandria. We hear about brother against brother in that war. How about father against son? French Delaney walks in and he sees his father and he says, "Pa, it's good to see you." And his father, knowing his son is a Mosby Ranger, says, "Well, it's not good to see you." Mosby would write about what happened there at the Rose Hill Manor House in a letter to his wife. And he talked about how the father felt bad about how he greeted his son. So Colonel Delaney said, "Downstairs, there's some old shoes because I know how scarce they are in the Confederacy." And French Delaney had been on a raid just a week prior, and they had captured a Union sutler's wagon. This was a leather sutler's wagon. And French Delaney supposedly bent down, pulled up his pant legs, showed him these brand new Union boots, and said something to the effect, "Courtesy of the U.S. government." Mosby would take Colonel Delaney. They would make their way through Vienna. They would send him on to Richmond, and he would be put into the Castle Thunder. He would stay there for a year to a year and a half. He would be exchanged. He would come back to Fairfax County. He would survive the war. He would go on to become clerk of the court at Fairfax Courthouse. French Delaney, his son, would be involved in a fight with the 2nd Massachusetts Cavalry in June or July of 1864. He would be mortally wounded. And the sad thing about both of these men, 150 years later, nobody knows where either one of them is buried today. I'm involved in the Stuart Mosby Civil War Cavalry Museum and also with the Society. And whenever we find a ranger who does not have a marker on his grave, we make sure that a marker is placed so that man will not be forgotten. Now we have a Mosby ranger that no one knows where he's buried, and his father, who is a very prominent man in Virginia, and nobody knows where he's buried either. That's a sad epitaph. There was a house that was located at the corner of Frontier Drive and Franconia Road, and that house was called Oak Grove. The family that lived in that house was the Broders family, or the Broaddus family. They built that house in 1830. In the mid-1990s, they tore that house down in less than an hour. But there was Civil War history there, and there was a story about Mosby's Rangers there. The Boy Scouts had placed a marker inside of the family cemetery. The house was at the corner of Frontier Drive and Franconia Road. You had about 80 yards of open field, and then you had the family cemetery. In the early 1980s, they built an elementary school between the house and the cemetery. That is Forest Dale Elementary School. This marker that used to be in the family cemetery talks about there was a fight with Mosby's Rangers where Forest Dale Elementary School is today. That is the oral history of the Broaddus family. There is a historian in Fairfax County, and he wanted to verify that oral history. And he went to the house the day they were going to raise it, and he examined the wood because the story was the family ran into the house to evade the bullets during the fighting with Mosby's Rangers. And he looked at every piece of wood from that house, and what do you think he found? He didn't find anything! Nothing! But he was a good historian, and he wanted to make sure that he did a thorough job, and he went to his car, and he pulled out a metal detector. Now, he couldn't metal detect where the school is, but he went around the house, and he checked that ground very thoroughly. Now, what do you think he found? He still didn't find anything! But this man was determined to try to verify that story. And he went to another friend of mine that worked at the National Archives that I'd known for over 20 years. And he said, "Can you find something about a fight that occurred at the Broaddus place?" And this guy went through all the records, the operational reports, everything at the National Archives. And he also reviewed the memoirs. And after 2 weeks, he came back to this historian in Fairfax County. And unfortunately, this historian had to state that he could not verify that story. I was writing my book, This Forgotten Land, which was a tour book outside of the city of Alexandria, and I had a chance to take another look at what happened there. And the very first thing I did is I interviewed an old relic hunter. His name is John Burfield. He used to live in the Franconia, Groveton area. And he had relic hunted that area for over 40 years. So I called him up and I said, John, did you ever search the ground there at Oak Grove? And he said, Don, yes, I did. I said, John, you got to tell, what did you find? Tell me. He said, I found Sharp's bullets. I found them where the school is and across the street. And he said something to me that I'll never forget. He said, they were fired in anger. This was the first evidence that something had occurred there at the house. I decided to look at the ORs myself, and I found this one obscure document. And it said on the 30th of July of 1864, there was a fight against guerrillas in Springfield. It didn't say at the broadest place, but the broadest place is in the Springfield area. The next thing I did, when you're talking about guerrillas, there were two guerrilla units that operated in Northern Virginia. One was Mosby's Rangers, and the other one was Company H of the 15th Virginia, which was known as the Chinkapin Rangers. They would normally go out on raids with Mosby's men and would later be incorporated into his command. So when I wrote my book, I talked about this incident that occurred on the 30th of July, 1864 in Springfield. However, I could not confirm that that was the incident that occurred at the broadest place. Until Susan Hellman called me up one day and she said, I was transcribing this diary from Ebenezer Mason and it stated that there was a fight at the broadest place, the 30th of July of 1864. I was so elated that I'm on the board of directors for the Franconia Museum, and I wrote an article for the Franconia Museum newsletter talking about the verification of the fight at the broadest place. Somehow that newsletter made its way to a church behind where Edison High School is today. And a lady was walking in the church and she sees that newsletter. And she picks it up and she goes through it and she finds there's stories about ghosts. And her son loves ghost stories. So she takes that newsletter home and she reads those ghost stories to her son. Her husband comes home and he sees it and he picks it up and he sees the headline of the story, Fight at Broadest Place Verified, Mosby's Rangers. And he says, honey, do you remember the tombstone we have out in the yard that says John Broadus? This is where it belongs. Apparently, 25 years ago, before these two were married, as a prank, somebody had placed a tombstone on the sidewalk in front of their door the night before Halloween. But this lady did not throw that tombstone away. She kept it. And she would place it in different parts of her yard. He says, honey, we've got to get that stone back to where it belongs. So the wife called one of the members of our board of directors and said, we have the stone that belongs in the Broadus family cemetery. Who do we need to speak to? They called me up. They told me about the stone. I said, where do you live? I drove over to their house. They took me out back. I took pictures of them with their stone, Scott and Joanna Knowles. I called one of the descendants, a direct descendant of the Broadus family, and her name is Mary Smith. And I said, Mary, I have a part of the stone that belongs to your great-grandfather. What do you want me to do with it? She said, Don, would you be willing to take it to the cemetery right now? I said, I'm on my way. The cemetery is locked. There's a gate around it. The sign you had saw earlier that the Boy Scouts had provided has been taken away because of vandals. People had stolen some of the stones. She unlocked the gate, and we went in. And I want everybody to know that I had the honor to reunite the top part of that stone to the bottom part of that stone. And it is something I will never forget. I am so glad I do what I do, because this brings history to life. The last story I'm going to tell, it occurred on the 8th of August of 1864. John Singleton Mosby and about 50 Rangers come into Centerville, and he wants to do some damage. Doesn't really know what he wants to do, and he identifies a Ranger by the name of Walter Whaley. Mosby would give him three or four men and would send him down the old Braddock Road, and he said, find me some targets. Walter Whaley is gone for 3 or 4 hours. He would return to Centerville, and he would tell Mosby that he found 2 picket posts on the old Braddock Road. And Mosby decided he wanted those picket posts because he wanted those men. And he decides to give a man by the name of Lieutenant Joe Nelson 20 Rangers to go down the old Braddock Road and capture those men. Joseph Nelson goes down the road with his 20 men. He makes it to the very first picket post. They're Union troopers. They have horses. They see him. They fire a volley with their Sharps rifles. These Union troopers mount their horses, and they start racing towards Alexandria, and they escape. So he decides he's going to have to be a little more careful, a little more cautious. And he's hoping the second picket post has not been alerted that he is in the area. The second picket post is located in the old Franconia Elementary School. Joseph Nelson would make it to the school. He is not seen. There are Union troopers inside the house or inside the schoolhouse and outside. Nelson would ride with his men into the pines, and they would dismount from their horses, and they would pull out their weapon of choice, which for a Mosby Ranger was a Colt 44. They're racing towards the schoolhouse. They're firing their 44s. The men inside, they have Sharps carbines, and they fire a volley. And they run out the back of the schoolhouse. They mount their horses, and they start racing down Franconia Road. Nelson and his men race back to their horses, hidden in the pines, mount their horses, and they start chasing the fleeing Yankees. James Williamson, one of Mosby's men, would write a book or a memoir after the war, and he talks about how they chased them by the Triplet Place. It was behind where Edison High School is today. So we know exactly where Nelson and his Rangers are chasing those Union patrols. There's another individual by the name of John Scott, and he would write a memoir, and he talks about this same incident that occurred on the old Fairfax Road, and he said he chased those Union troopers to within 3 or 4 miles of Alexandria. That would place them somewhere around Rose Hill or Mark Twain Intermediate School. So we've got an idea of how far they chased those Union troopers. And Nelson is actually successful. He would actually capture, depending on what report you want to believe, anywhere from 4 to 12 Union men. So Joseph Nelson has been a success, but now he's got a problem. Within 3 or 4 miles of Alexandria, there's thousands of Union cavalry, infantry, and artillery in the area. So can they use the roads? No. But Mosby has thought about this. He has given them a Ranger by the name of Albert G. Minor. And Ab Minor supposedly knows every shortcut and every towpath. He lived on the Little River Turnpike. He was a veteran of the Mexican War. He's in his mid-40s. He's going to lead that patrol through the woods to safety. It's late in the day. They're deep in the woods. And Albert Minor becomes disoriented. And everybody can hear him saying, if I could just find Bone Mill, I'll be okay. Well, there's a young teenager, and his name is William Trammell. William Trammell's got a sharp tongue. He walks up to Ab Minor. He calls him Bone Mill. And Ab Minor pulls out his revolver, and he shoots him. But he doesn't kill him. Nobody in Mosby's command ever called him Bone Mill ever again. Thank you very much for inviting me. I hope you enjoyed the stories that I told today. Thank you very much.
Of course, Mosby didn't do all this on his own. Eric Buckland will give us some insights into Mosby's Cadet Rangers.
Starting in January of 1863, Mosby began his operations with 9 men. And in 1865, when the unit was disbanded on the 21st of April, at least 800 men were formally mustered into the 43rd Battalion, Virginia Cavalry. Almost 2,000 men in total, counting those 800, had ridden with Mosby at one time or another. What I'd like to do today is talk about a small group of those men who rode with Mosby, and they're called Mosby's Cadet Rangers, and it's reference to men who went to VMI. But I would like to talk about those 58 men who matriculated at the Virginia Military Institute and also rode with Mosby's Rangers. Of that group, 21 of those men fought in the Battle of New Market with a corps of cadets. And if you're familiar with the history of New Market, that's a seminal moment in the history of that institution. Of these 58 men, 4 or 5 graduated prior to the war. Most of the men I call Cadet Rangers left from VMI, having been students and then became Rangers. A small group of those men actually rode with Mosby and then went to the Institute after the war. So you have a broad spectrum of when their affiliation with VMI actually began. But in 1864, the average age of these men was 18. The first is Charles Henry Deere, known as Charlie Deere. He was probably the first VMI student or cadet to leave VMI to end up with Mosby. He was 16 years of age. Now, in the next 26 months or so with Mosby, he was shot 12 times. In a fight at Mount Carmel Church in February of 1865, he got amongst Union cavalry with his pistols, as the Rangers were wont to do. They closed in with Union cavalry when they fought him, just up as close as they could with those pistols to make sure they were at their maximum effectiveness. Now, the fighting was so close that the Union cavalry could not come up with their rifles, but they could swing them. And they beat Charlie from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. But finally, on the 10th of April, the day after Lee had surrendered at Appomattox, the Rangers had their last fight at a place called Arundel's Tavern. And in that fight, the 8th Illinois Cavalry ran the Rangers off the field. And in that fight, Charlie Deere, along with his Ranger comrades, were trying to escape from the 8th Illinois, and Charlie's horse, Old Thunder, went down and rolled over on top of him. But he lived to be 82 years old. You see some photos as he's aged. You see pictures of his wife, Ada McGeorge Deere. In the town of Little Washington, Virginia, in Rappahannock County, where he lived after the war, he ran a boarding house and tavern. And the story goes that on Sunday evenings, he would have all the guests who were staying in the boarding house to dinner. Charlie would slice the meat, spear it with his knife, and then fling it down the length of the table onto the different plates. And they say that he never missed. Now, one guest, not knowing who Charlie was, made the mistake of referring to Mosby's Rangers as nothing more than cutthroats. So Charlie picked up that knife, with which he was quite adept, obviously, and laid it up along this guest's throat and suggested that he might want to take that comment back, which, of course, he did. This is John Carter Edmonds. John Carter Edmonds was 15, perhaps 16, when he joined Mosby. In early 1864, he and his roommate, John Munson, were at John Carter Edmonds' mother's home when they were preparing to go to a funeral for a Ranger who had been killed the day before, and the Rangers were going to collect or gather for a funeral for this Ranger named McCobb. So John Munson and John Carter Edmonds were going to ride to this funeral. And as they got ready to go, Mrs. Edmonds, Johnny's mother, who was quite religious, handed him a Bible and said, you don't know when you may need this. Please take it. So John took the Bible and shoved it into his pant pocket. Left, mounted his horse with Johnny Munson, left and went to this funeral. Word came up that a Union Cavalry element was in the area on a scout, and Mosby, of course, reacted to that. Basically, the funeral was all but ignored as the Rangers mounted and rode off to meet this threat. This started out in Loudoun County over near Paris, Virginia, if you're familiar with that area, almost to the Blue Ridge Mountains. This give and take of Mosby trying to find this Union patrol ended in the Second Battle of Drainesville, where Mosby's men essentially ambushed an element of the 2nd Massachusetts. And in that fight, John Carter Edmonds got into the middle of the fight and he was shot in the leg. Luckily for John, the bullet hit the Bible. It went through the Bible and got to the bone, but did not shatter the bone. Well, it appears that the Bible saved his leg. Bad wound, painful wound, bloody wound, but not as serious as it might have been. Carter actually recovered and he spent the rest of the war with Mosby. And then he went down and matriculated at Virginia Military Institute. He graduated in 1870 from BMI and then stayed there as a professor for a few years. But before the end of the 1870s, he and at least two of his brothers went to Texas. And it's when he got down there that John Carter Edmonds really began to shine. He became a mayor of Sherman, Texas. He was, for all practical purposes, the head of a small college for a few years in Texas. Come 1896, the bullet that he had received at the fight at Drainesville began to bother him because it was not taken out. And so he went to St. Louis and was operated on, and that bullet was in fact removed from his leg. And he kept it on a watch fob for the rest of his life, apparently to remind him of the good times he had during the war. In 1898, for a short period, John Carter Edmonds becomes the commandant of the Corps of Cadets at Texas A&M. And somewhere in that time as well, he becomes the colonel commanding of the 4th Texas Volunteer Infantry. But finally, we find him in 1907 as the superintendent of schools in Bastrop, Texas. A young boy named Brooks, the son of the assistant postmaster, a man named R.A. Brooks. Somewhere along the line, John Carter Edmonds expelled this man's son from school. But there was bad blood as a result between John Edmonds and R.A. Brooks. Allegedly, Edmonds' youngest daughter, shown here, Lucille, went into town to the post office to pick up her mail. And she supposedly was insulted in some shape or fashion by Mr. Brooks, and she came back and reported that to her father. John Carter Edmonds obviously was incensed. This was not a man to back away from a fight anyway, and he went into town to demand an apology. And he met him on the main street of Bastrop, Texas, and he told him his purpose for being there. And Brooks said, "I didn't say anything, and I'm not going to apologize." The pistols come out, and 6 rounds are fired. One finds its mark, and that's in the chest of John Carter Edmonds, and he's dead before he hits the ground. This is John Tyler Waller, the grandson of President John Tyler. In the book, Women of the Debatable Land, John Tyler Waller is referred to as the incarnation of recklessness. It may be that when the war started, he was but 16 years old, and more than likely, he fought at the Battle of Ball's Bluff in late 1861. He most definitely was in the Peninsula campaign with a Confederate unit in 1862, where he was severely wounded. He then went to Virginia Military Institute for 12 days. He was asked to leave the Institute and to stay out of the Institute, probably told to stay out of the town of Lexington and probably told to stay out of the county as well. His father did have some pull, or family had some pull, and he became a naval midshipman for a short period, but the report goes that he spent more time in the brig than anything else. At the same time, it seems he might get into trouble. As I said, He fought at Ball's Bluff. He came back. He fought in the Peninsula Campaign. He was badly wounded in that fight. He was noticed for heroic activities while he was with the Navy down in Charleston Harbor. There were reports that he actually tried to swim torpedoes to sink a Union ship. So this young man was not lacking for courage in any shape or form. He stayed near the Plains once he had joined the Rangers, and he became engaged to a young woman named Cornelia Foster. Now, it's said that John Tyler Waller was about 5'5", and from everything I've read, Cornelia Foster was somewhat Amazonian in stature, much taller than John was. And the story goes that John had been at the Foster house one day, had finished his visit with his fiancée. When he walked out the front door, he noticed that there was a detachment of Union cavalry coming up the road. He was not mounted. He had nowhere to go, so he ran back into the Foster home. Cornelia very quickly saw what the problem was. Perhaps John explained it to her as quickly as he could. And she stood there in the foyer of the house in this, of course, beautiful hoop dress as the women wore back in those days. And hearing John's plight, she looked down at her dress and nodded and lifted the front of her dress. And John scooted up under her hoops. Almost as soon as he had found his hiding place, the Union cavalry came in the front door of the Foster house demanding to know where that rebel they had seen had gone to. And she said, he came in the front door, went out the back. I don't know where he's gone. I don't know who he was. And apparently she was quite calm and collected as the Union cavalry began to search the house. And of course, they didn't find anything. Now, a few weeks later, John is back in the Plains area with another ranger named Harry Sinnott. They're not at the Foster home. They're at another house visiting the people there when once again the call comes out, Yankees. Harry Sinnott hears this. He's a ranger, goes out the back door, hops on his horse, hops a fence, and he's gone. John Tyler Waller goes out the front door, calmly mounts his horse, wheels it to face the Union cavalry, draws his pistol, and goes to work. The Union cavalry, confronted with an enemy, draw their carbines, and they empty John Tyler Waller's saddle. He's dead, more than likely, before he hits the ground. Now, the Union cavalry commander of that detachment said the following: let his friends know that he has fallen, that he may have every respect shown him, for he was the bravest soldier I ever fought. Now that's early 1865. The 8th Illinois Cavalry had been around. That says a lot for John Tyler Waller that this Union officer made that comment. And John Tyler Waller is buried in Warrenton Cemetery. If you were to walk directly back from his marker, you would actually walk to John Singleton Mosby's grave. They're about 30 meters apart or so. And at the bottom of the grave, which you cannot see today, it's so worn, is the Latin phrase, dulce e decorum est pro patria mori. It is sweet and proper to die for one's country. And he actually chose that epitaph several months before he was killed. This is William Benjamin Palmer. Ben Palmer, as he was known, was about 19 years old when he left VMI. Mosby handpicked his officers. So Ben Palmer, a lieutenant, was handpicked by Mosby. He's the kind of man that I respect as an officer. He wouldn't ask his people to do things that he himself would not do. In a place called Gold's Farm in the Valley in the summer of 1864, Palmer was in command of a small detachment. He was trying to get around the flank or the side of the Union cavalry who were engaging the Rangers. And as they made them move around to the flank of the Union cavalry, they came to a fence with a gate that was locked. And Palmer turned to a man named Jarman and said, "Jarman, get the gate." Jarman got off his horse, was immediately shot and killed. He turned to another ranger, Palmer did, to a ranger named Iden, said, "Iden, get the gate." Iden got off his horse. He was shot and killed. Palmer then dismounted, and he himself went up to the gate and opened it. and they rode through. And that's the kind of action I respect in a man. Now, in 1867, the Rangers had a dance in Warrenton. Etiquette of the time had the young ladies at the dance with a dance card. The first person on the card would be that special beau, that boyfriend, the fiancé, or at a minimum, the man that brought you to the dance. And then a young lady was expected to move and mingle. And you'll see here W.B. Palmer, William Benjamin Palmer. The young lady's name was Janet Weaver. And Weaver family tradition has it that she, Janet Weaver, and Ben Palmer were in fact engaged. For whatever reason, they did not marry. Janet Weaver went on to become famous in her own right as a woman named Mrs. Norman Vincent Randolph. But I could not, for 3 or 4 years, could not find any evidence that Ben Palmer had ever married. But finally I found he had done pretty well, and I have quite a bad crush on this young lady. This is Ellen Nall, who did marry Ben Palmer. She was about 10 years younger, known as one of the most beautiful debutantes in the area, came from a very wealthy family. When he passed away, he had become a very successful businessman in Richmond. And with some of the money left to her, she gave almost $30,000 to the Museum of the Confederacy, which back in those days was just about bankrupt. So she really kept it up on its feet and was able to go forward. She was also very active in caring for stray animals. And again, with the help of her husband before he had died, the Palmers were very instrumental in the founding of the SPCA of Richmond. George Rahm is an interesting character. You will find Rahm early on in the war as a courier for Joseph Johnston. Johnston is wounded. The next time you find Rahm is at Fredericksburg, and he's become known to Stonewall Jackson. And Jackson gets him an appointment to VMI. Again, he's a young man, perhaps 17 years of age. He goes on to VMI eventually after the Gettysburg campaign and fights at the Battle of New Market with the Corps of Cadets. This is the medal given to all those men who were at VMI during the Battle of New Market. 247 marched from VMI in Lexington about 4 days before the fight, marched 80 miles, and went almost right into combat once they got up to New Market. After the war, he headed out to the West Coast and became a very successful businessman. He married. Her maiden name was Woodward, and her father ran a place called Woodward's Gardens in the Bay Area around San Francisco. Basically, from everything I've read about Woodward's Gardens, imagine owning Disneyland. And so not only was Rahm successful by himself, his wife's daddy had some money too. So they lived pretty well. And they decided to go on a multiple year tour of the world. And Rahm wrote this book shown here, A Tour Around the World, which gives some very interesting insight into different parts of the world as they traveled. Little things like a private audience with the Pope, attending the coronation of the Tsar of Russia. Somewhere along the line, he was commissioned a colonel of engineers. This is what the Sphinx looked like when he began excavation on it. That's how we know it today. He is the man who discovered the feet or the legs. He's the man who found the temple that's between the legs of the Sphinx. There had also been a cap or a crown on the top of the Sphinx that had fallen between the legs of the Sphinx. And all of that can be credited to George Edward Rahm, a cadet ranger. He apparently came back with multiple artifacts from that tour that he took with his wife and wanted to found a museum in the Bay Area. There were no takers, so we only can guess where some of those treasures he had might have gone. The last photo I'd like to show is simply how history in general is a living, almost breathing thing. When I did my first edition of Mosby's Cadet Rangers, I had a terrible copy of a copy of a terrible copy of this photo. When I did the second edition, I had found more information on some of the Rangers. I still had a bad copy of a bad copy of a bad copy. Suddenly, a descendant of William Henry Talley tracked me down and said, I have a few things on Talley I'd like to share with you, to include the original of that photo. His photo was a cadet at VMI. The family owns his class of 1870 VMI ring. When you graduate from VMI, you were given a Bible. As you cross the stage, you get your diploma, you're given a Bible. The family also has the Bible. He did not live, perhaps, to have some of the adventures some of the other men I spoke about, but he lived a good life. Down in Flavanna, married a woman who's quite a bit younger than him. It was a successful businessman down in that area and very well respected. And again, these new things, as I said, the history, it doesn't stop. That's why we do this, because as you continue to peel back the skins of that, the layers of that onion, you find these nice little things, these little tidbits that make an area all that more meaningful, just like Blenheim. And that concludes my briefing. Thank you.
We hope you've enjoyed this edition of the Fairfax Scene. If you would like to learn more about Mosby and his men, or about the Civil War in general, stop by the Civil War Interpretive Center on Old Lee Highway. You can also pick up your own copy of Mosby's Raid on Fairfax Courthouse. For the Fairfax Scene, I'm Rachel Roth, and we'll see you next time.